Hello everyone, thanks to all of you for joining today's webinar. I hope you all are enjoying your good health. So today we would be discussing about this shift in the GST liability from the restaurants to the food aggregator. I and Poonam would be taking you through to this webinar in the following format. First, we will discuss about the GST, different GST provisions relating to ECO on which ECOs are liable to pay GST. Then a process flow, how this particular industry works. What is the process being followed by the these food aggregators in the existing scenario? And what would be the proposed or the post-amendment scenario which they would follow? Then we will be discussing about few aspects relating to the GST, that is taxability, input tax credit, registration, payment of tax, TCS, and then few compliance related provisions. At the end of the session, we would be highlighting few of the open points which on which we expect that a clarification should be issued by the CBIC. So now I'm handing over this session to Poonam. Over to you, Poonam, please.
Thank you, Sunil. And thank you, everyone. A very good evening to all of you. Thank you for joining today's session. As Sunil mentioned, today's webinar is to discuss the proposed shift in GST liability on the restaurant services which are supplied via e-commerce operators. For the purpose of today's conversation, we will be referring to e-commerce platforms that facilitate supply of restaurant services as food aggregators. Also, for the transactions and business models discussed in today's session, are all based on the general practices followed in the food aggregator industry. We are not commenting on any business model or business transaction of any specific food aggregator or restaurant per se. So before we talk about the proposed amendment, we would like to take you through the GST landscape for electronic commerce operators. Now, the definition of the EC, for the purposes of this slide, we have referred to the term ECOs as the short form ECOs. For GST purposes, the liability on ECOs is comparatively more complex and rigorous. On one hand, the ECOs are liable for GST as a supplier in their own capacity. The services that ECOs typically provide on their own account include commission charges, the listing charges which are levied from the vendors listed on the platform. At times, there are delivery charges levied, some advertisement charges levied, and other value-added services. Now, for such services, the e-commerce operators are required to provide, to pay the GST on their own account, just like any other supplier. There is another hat that an ECO is required to wear for GST purposes, which is the ECO is deemed as a supplier for notified services. These notified services currently are the cab operator services, housekeeping services, and hotel accommodation services. And now, from 1st of January 2022 onwards, these notified services are going to include restaurant services. Now, the enabling provision for levy of GST on ECOs as deemed supplier is provided under Section 9(5) of the GST Act. Apart from this, the e-commerce operator is also required to pay TCS on certain goods and services which are supplied over their platforms other than the notified services. So all in all, the ECO is liable to GST in three different capacities: as a supplier, as a deemed supplier, and as a collector of tax at source. It's important to note that the definition, the liability as a deemed supplier and as a collector of tax at source are mutually exclusive. So if on a particular transaction, the ECO has a liability to pay tax as a deemed supplier, it would not be required to pay tax as a collector of tax at source. For today's session, we are not focusing on the liability of e-commerce on its own account. We are essentially focusing on the proposed amendment, which is to cover the GST for on the e-commerce operator as a food aggregator. For that purpose, let's look at the definition of e-commerce operator. The GST law defines e-commerce operator as any person who owns, operates, or manages digital, electronic facility or platform for electronic commerce. The term e-commerce has also been defined as supply of goods or services or both, including digital products over digital or electronic network. The enabling provision, like I said, under the GST law for notifying services on which an e-commerce operator is liable to be taxed as a deemed supplier are under Section 9(5) of the Central GST Act. And correspondingly, the state GST legislations also provide for similar provisions. So from 1st of January, what is going to change is that the food aggregators, apart from paying GST on their own services, are now going to be liable to pay GST, which is on the supply of restaurant service at the rate of 5%. Now, this has an exclusion. The services which are supplied through specified premises are not to be covered within the food aggregator's liability. Now, what are specified premises? There is a definition for that under the notification, which is that the premises which provide hotel accommodation service and have declared tariff of any unit of accommodation above 7,500 per unit per day or its equivalent. The rationale of excluding these services is that the large hotels who have their own restaurants, even though they may have the facility for ordering the food online, their liability is not going to shift to the food aggregator. For them, they will be paying GST on their own account only. One important aspect of this notification is that it does not define what is a restaurant service. Now, how this absence of definition will impact the stakeholders, we'll be shortly discussing that. Let's look at why did the government actually think of bringing this amendment. This is basically an attempt for the government to tap the unorganized sector of restaurant services and cloud kitchens to bring them effectively under the GST network. The good news for the smaller restaurants is that they will be relieved of undertaking GST compliances. The positive side of this for the government is that it is a revenue augmentation opportunity for the government, because for the e-commerce operator, the liability to pay GST starts right from rupee one, as opposed to restaurants who have the turnover below the threshold. They are not required to pay GST as of now. All in all, there will be an ease of enforcement of GST for the revenue authorities for the restaurant services. Now let's look at a typical business model of a food aggregator, which involves four primary steps. the first step in this regard is where the customer goes onto the online platform, places its order on the platform. As the order is placed, the step two arises where the payment is collected online by the food aggregator. Now, there may be an exception to this rule. Some of the food aggregators may allow for collection of cash at the time of delivery. Step three is delivery of food. For this, the delivery partner picks up the food from the restaurant's premises and delivers it to the customer. And finally, the payment that has been collected by the food aggregator is remitted by them to restaurant after deducting their applicable commission and other charges, which today include TCS as well. And they also remit it the payments that are to be made to other vendors, which could include delivery partners. This slide basically summarizes what I just said. Now let's look at today, how does the whole process flow look like from a GST perspective? Currently, the restaurants issue a tax invoice on to the customer. The payment is remitted by the customer either online or cash on delivery to the food aggregator. The food aggregator then remits back the payment to the restaurant and other delivery partners. And on their services that are for the remittances to the restaurant, they also deduct a TCS. With effect from January 1, 2022, this process flow will change from a GST standpoint. The restaurants that were hitherto issuing tax invoice will no longer be issuing a tax invoice onto the customer. For their accounting purposes, they may continue to issue a commercial invoice. However, the tax invoice for the services will be issued by the food aggregator. Since the tax liability will be collected and discharged by the food aggregator, on these transactions, the TCS implications will go away. So in nutshell, what changes for the restaurants? They are no longer going to be liable to pay GST on their restaurant services, which they render via the food aggregators. However, for any dine-in services, they will continue to be liable to pay GST. If there are any other services that the restaurant owners are supplying, they will be continuing to pay that GST also. For the food aggregators, they will step into the shoes of the restaurant and they would be required to pay GST like a supplier. Other than that, for the services that are rendered by them on their own account, there will be no changes in the GST implication. Important point to note is that this amendment is only shifting the GST liability from the restaurants to the food aggregators. All other aspects of taxation, which include the application of rate of tax, the determination of place of supply, determination of value, etc., will continue to apply as before. There are few interpretational issues that are tagged to this proposed amendment. One such interpretational issue is whether the cloud kitchens qualify as restaurants for the purpose of discharge of food aggregators' liability. Cloud kitchens are typically those places where only food is prepared and which is delivered on the premises of the customer on order. There is no facility for on-premises eating of food by the customers. Now, in this regard, what's important to note, like we said, that the restaurant services are not defined under the GST Act, nor there is this definition under the notification issued under Section 9(5). The definition of restaurant services is given under the rate notification. However, that the rate notification specifically mentions that the definition of restaurant services is specifically for the purposes of the said notification. Therefore, that definition cannot apply for the purposes of determining food aggregators' liability. That leaves only one choice, that we look at what is restaurant in common parlance. Now, if we look at that, in common parlance, in my view, a restaurant is a place where food is prepared and served. We looked through multiple dictionary meanings of the term restaurant, and all of them refer to one common feature, that restaurant is a place where food is prepared and served to the customers. Now, this kind of a dichotomy leads to the interpretation that cloud kitchens per se are not restaurants. Now, if that is the interpretation, what it means is that food aggregators will not be liable to pay GST liability if the food is ordered and delivered by a vendor that is a cloud kitchen. Now, while we say that, we totally acknowledge that this kind of an interpretation leads to a very absurd result. It totally defeats the very purpose of the shift in liability of GST to the food aggregators. A large part of the food aggregator industry actually caters to cloud kitchens. Now, if that segment itself gets excluded from the food aggregator's liability, the whole amendment becomes almost redundant. It is therefore imperative that the CBIC clarifies this aspect very clearly. There's one more interpretational issue that is likely to come up, which is that at times the food aggregators also collect certain additional charges, which could include the delivery or special packaging charges, etc. Now, the question could be that will the food aggregators be liable to include such charges also collected since they are deemed supplier of restaurant services? The answer to this question, in our view, is no. While the food aggregators are deemed as supplier, that does not take away the fact that the collection of delivery charges and other charges is not on account of the restaurants. Typically, these charges are recovered by the food aggregators either on as an agent for another partner or on their own account. Either which ways, what happens is that these services are being provided separately by another person other than the restaurant. And therefore, the definition of composite or mixed supply, which requires the supply to be by a taxable person, will not get fulfilled. And by virtue of that, the trigger of max supply of composite supply rule will not apply here. To summarize, even if there are delivery charges or packing charges that are recovered by the food aggregator, which are separate and not remittable to the restaurants, will not be includable by the food aggregator for payment of GST on the restaurant services. Let's look at the input tax credit implications post the amendment. For the restaurants, the rate of GST applies, of 5% applies, with the condition that no input tax credit is used on the inward supplies that are used for supply of restaurant services. Point to be noted is that the condition for not claiming ITC is linked with the nature of service, for the service transaction per se, and not with the person who is liable to pay GST. Thus, even with the shift in the liability, the restaurants cannot avail the input tax credits on their inward supplies for restaurant services. On the other hand, the food aggregators, these are for sure not eligible for any of the inward supplies of the restaurants. However, for their own inward supplies, they were eligible up until now, and they will continue to be eligible for ITC even post the amendment. This view is also confirmed by the CBEC circular. One particular question that may arise is that what if the food aggregators are incurring certain additional expenses solely for the purposes of discharge of their food aggregator liability? Will that be considered as an inward supply in the hands of the food aggregators? And hence, will those expenses be ineligible for ITC in the hands of the food aggregators? The answer to that, in my view, is no. The food aggregator, even if it incurs such additional expenses, will still be incurring these expenses in its own account as in the capacity of a food aggregator, not as a restaurant service provider. Therefore, the restriction that is applicable on the restaurant suppliers will not apply even with respect to such additional specific expenses. With respect to the GST registration requirements, the restaurants will be required to be registered under GST as long as they do have services which are liable to GST. Now, one specific situation where a complication may arise is that after deducting the e-commerce operator related revenue, the restaurant's net revenue falls below the threshold limit. Will still the restaurant be liable to be continue to be registered and comply with GST? On this aspect, if we really look at the definition, the registration requirement under the GST law, it says that every supplier is required to be every supplier shall be liable to be registered if the aggregator turnover exceeds the threshold limit. The point that requires highlight is that it says if his aggregate turnover exceeds threshold limit. Now, once the liability itself gets shifted from the restaurant to the e-commerce operator, in my view, this threshold limit will not be to the extent the turnover is being relates to services which are supplied via the e-commerce operator, that is not includable. However, the CBIC circular on this point actually makes a contrary conclusion. This may lead to a debate between the supplier as to whether the smaller restaurants who are no longer above the threshold limit of registration, will they continue to be liable to be registered? The cloud kitchens who will have no turnover, which is liable to tax in their own hands, will they still be required to be registered and do necessary compliances under GST? The debate remains, and it's a call that the restaurants will need to take on a case-to-case basis. It is, in our view, arguable that once the law itself clearly says that the aggregate turnover has to be considered vis-a-vis the supplier, and the supplier itself is deemed, the e-food aggregator itself is deemed as a supplier, then restaurants should no longer be considered as supplier purely for calculating the aggregate turnover. On a safer side, if the restaurants wish, they could comply with GST and they may continue to be registered under GST. That does not have any adverse implications, so to say. As far as the e-commerce operators are concerned, they are anyways, as of now, liable to be registered by default, since the threshold limit of registration is nil for the food aggregators, or for that matter, any e-commerce platform. Now, once that exists, they don't need to be registered additionally for discharge of liability on restaurant services. In sum and substance, the existing GST registration of the e-commerce operators will be sufficient for them for paying their GST and for undertaking necessary compliances. With this, I come to the end of the first part of the session. And now I invite my colleague Sunil to take the session forward from this point. Sunil, over to you.
Thanks, Poonam. Before taking the session forward, I want to take this opportunity to quickly explain you about Taxman's new product called as Taxman's Practice. We refer it as your virtual legal assistant. Let me share my screen. I'll take 2 to 3 minutes to explain this. Yes. So this is the, from here you can reach out to this product. This is Taxman's Practice platform. You can find any of your query just by typing your query on this search engine. For example, if you have a query relating to e-commerce operator, just write it here and you would find the relevant document. The document is being prepared and maintained by the team of professionals, chartered accountants, company secretaries, and advocates in their respective domains. So we have launched the income tax platform of Practice. We are working on the GST, FEMA, Companies Act, and Accounting Standard, and it would be launched shortly. Each of our document on our platform is being prepared following the triple S approach, that is simple, structured, and searchable. So anything you can find on this platform, there are approximately 700 different topics on which the income tax team of Taxman has worked, which is readily available on this platform. So you can just find it on this platform. So with this, let me take the session forward. Okay. Sumita ma'am, can you please present the slide? I think there is some issue. Yes. Okay. So, yeah. Thanks, Poonam. Thanks for the insights. So, next point is payment of tax. As Poonam has explained you that in respect of restaurant services, the food aggregators would be liable to pay GST. So after 1st January 2022, there would be no GST liability in respect of restaurant services in the hands of restaurants. However, in respect of dining services and other supplies, be it goods or services, the restaurants or the registered person would continue to be liable to pay GST under the forward charge mechanism. Important to note that one of the very important point is that for discharging your GST liability as a restaurant, you can very well utilize your ITC, which is available from the other business segments. So there is no restriction under the GST law for using the ITC, which is otherwise available to you, in order to discharge your GST liability of restaurant services as well. As far as the food aggregators are concerned, since the liability has been shifted to the food aggregators, so a food aggregator would be liable to pay GST at the rate of 5% on the restaurant services. Again, there is no restriction under the GST law for claiming the ITC, for utilizing the ITC against this liability. If you carefully read the notification, which provides the restriction relating to claiming the ITC, it provides that ITC shall not be available of goods or services used for supplying the restaurant services. So there is no condition under the GST law for utilization of the ITC, which is otherwise available, in order to discharge the liability of restaurant services. The law says, as far as the payment of tax is concerned, that is you can, for discharging your output tax, you can use the balance available in the electronic credit ledger. And the output tax has been defined that the liability which is there under the law. So for food aggregators, the liability in respect of restaurant services equally qualify as the output tax. So they can very well utilize the ITC, which is otherwise available to them in their normal course of business. Notably, the CBIC has, you know, clarified in a different way. They have said that the food aggregators would be required to pay this amount in cash only. In other words, they cannot use the ITC, which is available to them in their normal course of business. In our view, it is available. There is no restriction under the GST law. Now, what would be the fate of tax collected at source after this amendment would come into effect? So currently the law provides that every e-commerce operator would be liable to collect the tax at the rate of 1% on the net value of taxable supplies made through them in the scenarios where the consideration is received by the e-commerce operator. The net value of taxable supply has been defined in a way that it excludes the transaction in a scenarios where the e-commerce operator would be liable to pay tax themselves. So, since after 1st January 2022, the food aggregator would be liable to pay GST on this service, the impound services. Therefore, in respect of these supplies, there would be no TCS. However, in respect of other goods or services which are provided through their platform, that is services or goods on which Section 9(5) is not applicable, in respect of those services and goods, TCS provisions would continue be applied. Now, what would be the documentation requirement? From restaurant's perspective, if we see the GST law says that every registered person who is supplying the taxable services would require to issue a tax invoice. Since the GST law, by virtue of Section 9(5), has deemed the ECO as the supplier of services, therefore, it can very well be said or argued that for the restaurant services, ECO would be supplying the taxable services, because the law has deemed ECO as a supplier. Thus, the provisions relating to tax invoice, credit notes, etc. would be applicable on the ECO, and ECO would be required to issue the tax invoice, etc. But a question may arise, how we can get our payments from the ECOs? There needs to be some documentation, etc. There needs to be some documents. For that purpose, you may commercially issue the commercial invoice, financial credit notes, etc., as you agree may with your food aggregator. From food aggregator's perspective, as I said, since the food aggregator has been deemed as a supplier, therefore, all the documentation requirement of the GST law would be required to be followed by the food aggregator. How to report these transactions in our GST return? As I said you that there is no requirement to issue any document under the GST law when it comes to the restaurant. Further, under the GST returns, there is no specific column or field where you can report these transactions whenever the liability is shifted to some other person. There is no reporting field. But CBIC has clarified that you can report these transactions as exempt supply in Form GSTR 1 in Table 8 and in Form GSTR 3B in Table 31C. These relates to the exempt supply. For food aggregators' perspective, this would be treated as normal output tax supply, and the way you report your transaction, be it B2B or B2C, in a similar way, you have to report your transaction in GSTR 1 and GSTR 3B. Now, one of the question is, can I issue the bill of supply as a restaurant in respect of the services which I have provided to the food aggregators? So one of the participants has asked this question. You would not be required to issue any bill of supply. Why? Because bill of supply is required to be issued in respect of exempt supplies. These supplies technically or legally are not exempt supply, though the clarification provides that you can report these transactions in the field where you are required to report the exempt supplies, but these are technically not the exempt supply. Therefore, bill of supply legally is not required to be issued. You can very well issue the commercial credit note, financial commercial invoice, financial credit note, etc. With this, there are a few open points. First is, will ITC be available on additional expenses or not? As Poonam explained to you that in our view that ITC very well be claimed, but this is an open point because the way the law is drafted, there exists a two-way interpretation, right? So we expect a clarification. We request the CBIC to issue a clarification. Will the ITC would be allowed in respect of these expenses or not? The goods which are supplied through e-commerce operator platforms, sometimes you may find that you are just ordering a packaged food, say a bottle of Coke from X restaurant. So if you see, practically they charge 5% GST only. So the question is, if I'm just supplying the packaged food, will it be a goods or will it be treated as a restaurant services? Because if it's treated as a restaurant services, then there would be a GST liability on the e-commerce operator. But if it is not treated as a restaurant services, then there would be a TCS liability on the e-commerce operator. So clarification in this regard is the essence of the art. CBIC should clarify that how to treat these transactions. What would be the fate of the cloud kitchen? As Poonam has explained in detail, that whether these cloud kitchens would be qualified as restaurants or not, it needs to be clarified by the CBIC. And these are two open points as far as the clarification is concerned. First is that ECO cannot utilize the input tax credit, which is otherwise available to them, in order to discharge the GST liability in respect of restaurant services. As we explained, that in our view, there is no restriction under the GST law for utilizing such credit for discharging your GST liability of restaurant services. So, we can, as an industry bodies, etc., they can represent to CBIC for revisiting this position, or suitably they can amend the law so that there should be a clarity as far as the law is concerned and the applicability on the practical aspect is concerned. The second is the validity of the argument that from restaurant's perspective, the value of supply of restaurant services would be included in the aggregate turnover in order to decide the threshold limit for registration and various purposes. See, when we see the definition of the aggregate turnover, it has been, one can say that it is being covered in the definition of aggregate turnover. And when it comes to registration provision, there they specifically, as Poonam explained, there they specifically provide that if your aggregate turnover exceeds. So if I am treated as a supplier, a food aggregator is treated as a supplier. So it would be his supply, not the supply of the restaurant. So if it is not my supply, how you can, add this turnover in my turnover in order to determine where is threshold limit under the GST law. So these are few open points which are one would want that CBIC should clarify. Right. Yeah. With this, I would be now taking the queries of the participants. Poonam, can you please on your camera? There is one query relating to registration. I'm reading the query. Vijay has asked this question. Since the restaurants are not required to pay GST on supply and are not eligible to take ITC, does it now make any sense for such restaurants to take GST registration?
Totally, Vijay. Your point is valid. And that's exactly the dichotomy that we highlighted in today's session. In our view, there is no reason why government should continue to require the restaurants to be registered and to report their GST turnovers when the liability has been shifted onto the food aggregators. However, having said that, like we have seen, the law interpretation actually leads to exclusion of the turnover, and therefore the liability on restaurants who are only supplying via food aggregators, they should not be required to be registered under GST. Unfortunately, this point has been clarified to the contrary by the CBIC. So there's not much scope of debate, as so to say. If you are comfortable to take a stand, which is literally possible as per the interpretation of law, then the restaurant is not required to pay to be registered. But you should be ready to face a challenge from the department if you take that position.
Right. Another query is from Sanidhya ji. Kindly discuss about the invoicing format as well as the accounting entry. Sanidhya ji, I'm not sure about the accounting entry, how it will be go. I need to think through it. You can write this query to us. I'll forward this query to my accounts and audit team. They will be taking care of. You can write it us on sales@taxman.com. Invoicing format, you can follow any format because this would not be a legal document from restaurant's perspective. So whatever format suits you, you can add those fields, etc. So you can follow any format. Okay. Will it be true to issue bill of supply? As I explained to you that it is not a exempt supply per se under the GST law. So technically you are not required to issue bill of supply also. Deepak ji, whether supply of juices by juice outlet through e-commerce operator would be covered under the term restaurant service. Very typical and to the point question. Poonam, would you like to answer? Yeah.
Thanks. Deepak, thanks for asking that question. The answer to that is yes, they are covered within the definition, within the food aggregator's liability, provided the food outlet per se qualifies as a restaurant. Now, how will that point be determined whether the food outlet is a restaurant depends on whether the facility also provides for consumption of food at the outlet, the juices at the outlet itself. That is the technical interpretation and view that we have. However, that, as we've said in the session, this kind of an interpretation leads to the absurdity that a large chunk of the GST liability on food aggregators will get excluded if this literal interpretation is applied. Therefore, on a safer side, the juice outlets should consider the liability to be that of the food aggregator to be on the safer side that no GST liability is asked for to be paid by the juice outlet itself, they should write to their jurisdictional GST office that they are the GST liability on their turnover is being discharged by the food aggregator.
Right. I think this issue is quite more clear than when we compare it with the ice cream parlors. There, the government has made a mess, though they are, you know, they have said that they would be deliberating this issue again in the upcoming GST Council. But when I compare the ice cream parlors with this juice corners, I think they can very well be called as restaurants nonetheless.
Yeah.
Okay. Dheeraj ji, is it free? Dheeraj ji, this webinar is free. We would be uploading this webinar maybe after 2 to 3 days on our YouTube channel. You can find the recorded version there, right? Okay.
There is one more question that has just come in, Sunil.
Sure. I'm reading it. Whether the movement of goods from restaurants to the ECO will be covered under the invoice to add to their turnover, that the restaurant should issue invoice for the supply of food. Poonam, should I read it again? Whether the movement of goods from the restaurants to the ECO will be covered under any invoice to add to their turnover, that the restaurants should issue invoice for the supply of food.
And this query is from?
Mr. Manoharan.
Manoharanji, typically, like we've shown the business model that is followed in the food aggregator industry, the food does not get delivered or moved. It does not move from the restaurant to the food aggregator's premises. So that is not the general practice. However, to address your specific scenario, if such a movement is required, then that movement can happen under the cover of a delivery challan. And a tax invoice or a bill of supply is not required to be issued by the restaurant in this case.
Right. Okay. Mr. Rupral, which type of invoice will be created by a restaurant or cloud kitchen, bill of supply or tax invoice? None of these documents, sir, because it's not a supply of the restaurant per se. And that is where we highlighted that as a restaurant, you can issue a commercial invoice or for returns, etc. You may issue the financial credit notes. So under the GST law, you would not be required to issue any sort of document. Again, one more question from Mr. Manoharan. If the invoice is to be issued by restaurants, whether it will be non-GST bill, that is bill of supply, whether e-way bill, if any, should be prepared by the restaurant? No, sir. I think the first query I have answered it. But for second query, e-way bill, since it is not a goods per se, so e-way bill is required for the movement of goods. These are services under the GST law. So for restaurant services, whenever you are delivering the food to the customers, you would not require to comply with any of the e-way bill provisions. And how the quantum will be known to the restaurant? So that is an issue. Now, that's why we said that you can issue the financial invoice, etc. to your food aggregator and may reconcile your transactions with them. As final payment for goods delivered is with restaurants, should it be included in the aggregate's turnover? See, Poonam, would you like to answer this?
Sure.
The question is...
Yeah, okay. I can read the question.
Yeah.
So, Sanidhya, the restaurant, the GST law says that the liability to register for a supplier is when his aggregate turnover exceeds the threshold limit. Now, since the restaurants are not any longer a supplier for the purposes of discharge of GST liability, the aggregate turnover, to the extent that food is being supplied via the food aggregator platform is not to be included technically. However, like we said, the CBIC circular does not agree with this point of view.
Okay. Deepak ji, you said that there is no supply of food. I think this requires a research, but if I say my prima facie view, I feel that juices, etc. would well covered within the definition of food in my prima facie view, but it requires a research to conclude. Yeah. So I think we are done with the question, Poonam.
Yeah.
Thanks to all the participants for joining me today's webinar. I know the deadline is there for the compliances, etc. And you have managed your time for attending this session. Thanks to all of you for joining this webinar. Thanks, Poonam. Thanks to all of you. In case you have any query relating to any of these issues that we have discussed, you can write us over the mail sales@taxman.com, and we would be happy to revert to all of you. Thank you. Thanks.
Thank you, everyone. Thanks, Sunil.